If you're working on a catalogue, and if you're a numismatist, then you'll work on catalogues, a lot of your time is spent measuring things. This is a page from a draft of a catalogue I am working on, and you will see several measurements for each coin. In fact, the three most common measurements in ancient numismatics, weight, diameter, and the sometimes useful diaxes. None of this is rocket science, but it can be slippery, and by and large, it doesn't really get taught. This book by How'd You Go is often cited as a good introduction to numismatics. To be fair, it is, but it doesn't really cover any of this. Like most introductions to numismatics, it is primarily a history, not a guide to practice. The exceptions I can think of aren't in English. Measuring coins is just one of those skills you are supposed to pick up on the job. And since, unlike, say, archaeology, there aren't really university departments teaching numismatics, that doesn't always happen consistently. And in a moment, I'll give you an example of how this tripped me up many years after I first started numismatic research. Generally, there are two or three basic measurements you should take for every coin, whether you are doing an archaeological report, a museum catalogue, or simply writing an article. In an ideal world, you would always include each of these, and generally, you write them weight, the most important, diameter, and then axes. For explaining them, let's start with the axes. Diaxes is a description of the relationship between the two sides of a coin. If the obverse is upright, will the reverse be upright? This is measured, quite simply, by spinning the coin around. Hold it upright, with the design not rotated, then turn as if it were on a spindle running top to bottom. Apologies for the quality of the video here, my camera doesn't really do close-ups very well. Now that it's rotated, you can see if the reverse design is rotated relative to the obverse, which it is in this case. And it is that rotation you want to measure. A useful note, it does not matter which side of the coin you start with, you get the same result regardless. But, and this is the most common problem with numismatic measurements, there is more than one way to record this. In the case of diaxes, there are two, usually associated either with European or with Soviet traditions of scholarship. Take this small gold coin of Hormizd, spin it around, and you can see the reverse is clearly not orientated the same way. I would measure it like this. Imagine a clock face around the coin and use the hours on the clock. So in this case, an 11 o'clock diaxes. The other way to do this is by degrees, starting at 0 degrees at the top, counting round. In this case, the coin would have a 330 degree diaxes. Here is a useful little trick with the Hormizd coin I just showed you. If you only have photographs of a coin, but the edges of the coin are quite distinctive, say they have small divots like these two, when you rotate the coin, the position of those divots will be mirrored. You can use that to establish in photographs what the orientation would be. And that is not only a useful trick when you don't have direct access to a coin, it also makes it possible to do this with a computer. For example, the Ashmolean Museum in Oxford automatically records diaxes for its coins. Having said this, neither computers nor measuring in degrees improve your accuracy. There is always a wide margin of error in a diaxes, in part because it's quite subjective which way is up on a coin. Take this Ashmolean Carausius coin. Carausius is a 3rd century Roman usurper in Britain, and his coins are generally not well made. Do we take the direction of the figure and her staff, or orientate ourselves based on the ground line? Whoever was responsible for this photograph seems to have hedged their bets halfway between the two. I titled this video Two or Three Measurements because you don't always need a diaxes. Modern machine-made coins are very consistent. It's the same for every coin. That is basically true for cast coins as well. Obviously, some coins are uniface, and if you only have one side, the concept is pretty meaningless as it is when coins are made with punches. So you don't always need the diaxes to be measured. Though I will say, any time I've not recorded this for a coin where it might be meaningful, I've tended to regret that later. But let's move on to probably the most important measure, weight. You weigh coins with scales, and by and large, any modern electronic scale that measures to a hundredth of a gram will do. The main things that affect your accuracy are vibration, so measure on a flat table surface, or air movement, so turn off fans, close windows, etc. And of course, forgetting to zero your scales before you start. There is near universal agreement on units. Modern numismatists measure the weight of coins in grams. That wasn't always the case, and if you use an older catalogue, you will see weights in grains, abbreviated GR. Just to be clear, the correct abbreviation for grams is G. Grains were particularly popular with English numismatists, who use all sorts of silly measurements, and are a frequent source of confusion for French scholars, who have always been much more sensible about this sort of thing. I was once asked by a local museum, who'd seen a catalogue with weights to four decimal places, if they needed to do the same. Goodness no. Getting accurate measurements past a hundredth of a gram is really expensive. There are a few techniques, like specific gravity, which is a measure of density, where the increased accuracy of very expensive wind-shielded scales is worth it, but in general ancient moneyers were no more capable of producing flans more accurate than a hundredth of a gram than you are of measuring that. So for most normal purposes, the standard should be two decimal places. Finally, diameter. I left diameter to last because it's the measurement where practice is most variable and on which I come closest to being dogmatic. First of all, let's deal with the units. The numismatic convention is to measure the diameter of a coin in millimetres. Not centimetres, not decimal inches, as many old catalogues use, and definitely not Monet's scale. To be fair, I've never actually seen someone use the weird set of arbitrary numbered measurements that make up Monet's scale, but the fact that older catalogues felt the need to include conversion tables suggests that at some point somebody thought an irregular scale specific to coins was a good idea. And no, I don't know why numismatists used decimal inches when every ruler I've ever seen divides them into sixteenths. Again, the French have always been much more sensible, and everyone has long since seen the light and adopted millimetres. And yes, a ruler is fine. You don't need calipers for measuring a diameter, because, for very similar reasons to diaxes, measuring a diameter is somewhat subjective. And that also means you don't need to be particularly precise. Just round the nearest whole number. It's pretty much a waste of everyone's time to try and measure more precisely than that. One thing you will see, which is not a common numismatic convention, but is acceptable, is to photograph coins with a scale. This happens a lot in the portable antiquity scheme because scales are a common archaeological practice. And this is quite a good example. The scale is in millimetres, it alternates colours, so it's easy to read. In this case, it was clearly added to the image digitally, which is always more aesthetic pleasing than to just photograph with a ruler. And don't do that. Don't just photograph the coin with the edge of a clear plastic ruler, which will be really hard to read. Downside of this, and why it is not common practice for numismatics, is it takes a little bit of work to extract the actual diameter, and you have to edit out the scale to use the photo in almost all circumstances, which is a pain. On the other hand, if you're short of time, or are uncertain about which diameter to measure, this is a reasonable fallback. What do I mean, which diameter? You see, ancient coins are only kind of round, so not every straight line passing through the centre is the same length. And I got a rude awakening with this coin when a colleague and I both came up with different measurements. It turned out that I was measuring from top to bottom, but my colleague was measuring side to side. And this gets more confusing because when I asked other colleagues, it turned out that many of them weren't using either of these measurements. They were measuring whichever diameter was the largest. There are pros and cons to each of these. If you use the largest measurement, it doesn't matter which side of the coin you measure on. If you use a fixed direction, you have to do it on the obverse because the coin might not have a 12 o'clock diaxes. And obviously, you can see that would be a pain in an archaeological context if the coin has not been cleaned and you can't tell which side is the obverse or even necessarily which way is up, thus photographing with scales. However, in modern numismatics, there is an excellent reason to measure top to bottom. It makes sizing digital photographs much easier. In most cases, the vertical dimension of a photograph will correspond with the diameter you have measured, and it's no harder than using any other measurement if it doesn't. Of course, there are always exceptions. Generally, square or rectangular coins get two measurements. And if you get an octagonal coin, it's probably best to explain to your reader precisely what you are measuring. Octagonal coins are not common, but for a few hundred years, the Kingdom of Ahom did issue all of its coins this way. Other measurements? There are occasions for measuring thickness, density, or surface area, but they tend to be more limited in their utility or more complex to measure, so they're things you use occasionally rather than routinely. And what's the point of going through all of this? Essentially, this is the kind of basic stuff that all historical research starts from. You cannot study something until you've recorded it. You need to know that the way you're recording things is the same way that other people are recording things, or at least understand the differences. And these measurements are particularly useful. If you're managing a collection, then they can help you sort out if two coins have become mixed up. Historically, variations in diaxes are often very useful because well-established mints tend to care a lot about this. Unofficial or irregular mints tend not to, so you can distinguish production. And the weight standard of coins has been the subject of study amongst numismatists for a long time. And when people use the word metrology, which is the study of measurements, what they're usually referring to is the study of weight. And you will find entire books dedicated to the subject of why coins weigh the amount they do, why those weights change, and how those weights change. And of course, all of that discussion is fundamentally rooted in having reasonably accurate, fairly consistent measurements of the coins themselves. So like I said at the beginning, it's not rocket science, but it is important.